Hey everybody, welcome to the Bold Inventors Show. I'm your host, J.D. Hoovener, owner and founder here at Bold Patents Law Firm. I'm here with Matt, my trusty trademark attorney. Matt, good afternoon.
Well, hello there.
Hey, man. I'm going to get a little bit of water here. My voice is a little off, I would say. We're live across Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn. And I'm excited to get to this today. We have a guest, hopefully. We'll be logging in backstage in just a few minutes, Rodrigo Lima. We've had him on before, Matt. I don't know if you remember Rodrigo from Lime Design, based in Florida. Were you there?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah. So he's hoping to go through, you know, his top three product design tips. And then, of course, we'll do our Shark Tank Bold Bites segment. Had fun finding those, of course. I get to kind of just check out some fun ones. This one is a pitch where Mark Cuban gets offended, like almost immediately, puts these guys under the bus. So we'll look at that in about 15 minutes or so. Unless our guest, you know, isn't able to make it, then we might be able to jump sooner. Okay. So what's been going on, Matt? Anything on your mind these days?
You know, it's kind of coming to the end of summer, getting, you know, finishing up some trips, some family trips, catching up on some legal work. Things are going really well.
Good.
What about you?
Well, I mean, and I know you've seen a couple emails from me. I went to that dental conference last week down in New Orleans. Goodness, New Orleans is a whole different part of the country.
That's an adult dose down there for sure.
It really is. My wife and I were able to get down there. She came with me. We did a little business, a little husband-wife trip.
That's great.
I got like sweaty. Sweaty is one major word. I mean, August and 100 degrees, very humid. So it had some cool parts, kind of the old historical kind of French colony kind of stuff. Yep. And some really dirty, nasty parts of like Bourbon Street. It just felt really gross.
100%. I feel like that's like New Orleans. Take no offense to anyone down New Orleans, but that's kind of like its MO, right? It's like very cool, very dirty.
We did it one night, a couple nights. Highlight there was a really cool dueling piano bar we found.
Pedal Bright.
Really fun. So it was great. I made a couple good connections. For those who don't know, maybe I haven't talked much about it, but we are kind of a niche in the dental and orthodontic space. I've been becoming a well-known player there in terms of the go-to patent and trademark attorney for that industry. So I did two separate speaking events there, one live and then one that was, they call the dental side gigs. You know, a lot of dentists, not orthodontists, and those in the profession have side gigs, whether it be hygienists or the doctors themselves. Mm-hmm. And so I walked them through, we did kind of a branding and we did a deep dive on patent protection. So kind of first time for some of these folks.
Yeah. What do you think that is about, you know, dentists? Because obviously we have a lot of dental clients, but I mean, they seem to be like as a group more entrepreneurial than your typical MD.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm not familiar with, you know, what it takes to become a dentist. I think you do have to go to medical school.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then you've got to go to dentistry school. So to me, they're just as doctory as your medical doctor. But I don't believe they are considered MDs, right? For some reason.
Oh, okay.
So there's different school. And it's kind of like a chiropractor, I think. The biggest difference, super mega high level stuff, is that you don't usually, you know, doctors don't affiliate themselves with like in a larger group, kind of like, you know, you would an HMO or a PPO kind of thing.
Yeah.
They have their own office, meaning they're individual business owners. Hmm. And so, yes, while they're delivering a service, much like us, right, they have to do the marketing. They have to put together a sales, if you will, or put together an organization that will keep track of, offer the professional service, and still bring in new business. And so you'll see, I think, a lot of innovation with, you know, more marketing-y type of stuff than you would kind of your run-of-the-mill primary care physician.
Huh, interesting.
Yeah. We have a few, you know, doctors that are inventing stuff way outside of healthcare. Right. Of course, they're doing medical devices and our therapies and diagnostics, but we have a golf glove, I think we do. And we've got a yoga block, right? Dr. Kibbe's got his yoga somewhat medical, but it's not what he does day to day and day out. So you don't have to.
Well, we've got some authors too.
We do. Some
dental authors who do children's books. And
okay. Absolutely. Yeah. So there's a lot of that. So today we're going to talk about design. And this example, you know, I have on the Shark Tank show is interesting because it's one of these really simple things that you probably see almost daily if you spend a lot of time in your car. And this is it's a reinventing. Okay. And I get this question a lot from inventors is, actually, you know, my invention, it's not that earth shattering, right? I have something that I've been thinking about. I wonder if I can actually make money with it. This is a really cool example. And I think we'll just jump to it. Looks like Rodrigo's calling. Well, I'll go on mute, Matt. Maybe you could, maybe want to take up something related to trademarking and design, real quick. I'll go on mute.
Sure.
Does that work for you? Okay.
Yeah. Sounds good. So yeah, I'm going to ad lib here a little bit about, design marks and trade dress and design patents and that sort of thing. So it's pretty confusing for a lot of folks, unless you're kind of in this intellectual property space, when it comes to what is eligible for a design patent versus like a trade dress. And it kind of comes down to the purpose of the design, right? If it's a design mark, or sorry, if it's a trade dress, right, it's got some sort of functionality from a trademark perspective, meaning it, you know, denotes some sort of brand for the potential consumer of it. Whereas a design patent has some sort of aesthetic to it, but no functionality. I think that's a fair approach. JD, you back?
I am on the way back. I'm gonna try to get Rodrigo a little link out here in a second. Try to get on.
Okay. So,
let's see here. There it is. I'll resend that. So you're talking about
trade dress versus design patents. You know,
Yep. There
it does feel like there can be some sort of overlap between the two. Right. Obviously, when we talk about patents, you know, JD knows this better than I do, but there's utility and design patents and plant patents and a whole bunch of different stuff.
Right.
But at the end of the day, like, clients generally fall into the utility patent and sometimes design patents.
Right.
Utility patents generally more desirable if clients can get them. But when it comes to design patents, I mean, those have, you know, no functionality but serve some sort of purpose in terms of protecting the look and feel of something.
You got it.
Without the functionality, which is similar to trade dress, right? Trade dress can't have any functionality from a trademark perspective because that's the province of patents. But trade dress can be protected under trademark law, which is not subject to the 20-year rule, right, before it becomes public domain.
Yeah.
And trade dress can protect, kind of the aesthetics if those aesthetics serve to connect the consumer to the product. So trade dress is great. I think it's underutilized, underleveraged. I mean, I certainly think that we could probably do a better job steering clients towards trade dress applications. They are more complicated. They're inevitably more difficult to get because the USPTO gives a lot more scrutiny to them because they don't want any functionality as part of that trade dress. But trade dress can, you know, they can fall into product category, product design. They can be like the inside of a restaurant, for example. Product packaging could be trade dress.
Yeah, I mean, and sorry to interrupt. So trade dress, I mean, you can't get that right away, right? It's one of those things you have to wait a while to get.
Or can you get it. Really? You can get it right away. Yep.
Oh, okay. I had that wrong. We were chatting. I don't know where it was, but internally, I think it was. We were thinking that, oh yeah, you have to prove some sort of secondary meaning, you know, to get trade dress.
You potentially, if the trade dress is not obvious, right? Then you might have to prove secondary meaning that people have come to associate the product look and feel or the inside of this restaurant as having some sort of connection to a brand, right?
Got
so it offers a product or service. And if that's the case, then you may need to prove secondary meaning, which means that you have to go be in the marketplace potentially for 5 years and then maybe have to get some additional survey evidence. And that can be,
I always grab things on my desk. So this container here of chewing gum.
Yeah.
What do you think? It's got kind of a unique shape.
Sure. That's a unique shape. I don't see necessarily any functionality to that shape.
Right. It might fit in a cup holder, but, you know, maybe.
Maybe that's it.
So would the examiner maybe push back on that? Like, well, you know, it's obviously for gripping or for some functional aspect.
They may. I'm sure they probably would, just because that's what they're going to do for any trade press, is push back, you know, and ask questions. They might ask what the purpose of the design is. Does it serve a function? They might look at the website to see how it's advertised. That's a big one. If you on your website for icebreakers or whatever promote the fact that this container fits in a cup holder, well, that's functional.
All of a sudden. Right. Now we've got Rodrigo backstage. I want to bring him on.
Great.
Rodrigo, good afternoon, sir.
What's happening, guys? Good to see you both again.
Good to see you. Yeah, thank you for coming on. And it was actually my fault. I didn't get him the link, guys. So anybody out there is me at that. We were talking about chewing gum. I'm going to just throw a question. By the way, I love that book right there.
Yeah, it's nice.
Thanks for
I've read it twice.
What do you think?
Recommend it. Highly recommend it.
Oh, thank you, sir. Good job. This container, I don't know if you can see my screen, I got the Icebreakers gum container, right? Something really simple. From your perspective, what would it take to kind of come up with a final design, you know, for a package, for something like that, if someone has an innovative package or, you know, container?
Yeah, I mean, look, I treat most products pretty much, most ideas, I pretty much treat them the same way. There's a design process that we work you know, the idea through, and it starts with concept development, which is understanding, you know, the price requirements of the project, the user requirements, the materials, you know, and with that information, we can figure out a price point that makes sense to make that at. And the price point is very important, man. Like, so for a product like you're showing me, that packaging has to be made for like in the pennies, you know?
Okay.
And it would only be done in high, very high volume. So, you know, that lets you understand like the molds have to be larger and more cavities. The cheaper the product, the more fast you have to be able to make the parts, you know, like spit them out quickly. But the idea is to really sketch out the concept. We do the research first, see what the competitions do. Like what does the competition look like? Right. So we get a good analysis of your landscape. And then from there we can say, okay, well, these guys are doing very square things, but these guys are doing something cool, and you know, but maybe we can do something a little bit different. So we want to start looking for the angles that haven't been done already, because if somebody's doing something that's round and somebody that's square, I mean, well, okay, well, let's, what else can we, there's a million different shapes we can come up with. We don't have to make the exact same thing that somebody else is making, you know?
I love that. Okay. So you're not just taking what your customers give you and just going and building it. There is that, hey, let's look at the market. Let's look at the competitor. Right. I love that. Look,
JD, there are some clients that, you know, are very particular and they want things of exactly a certain way. And we can do that. That's not a problem. But the value that I bring really comes in helping the person understand, okay, I shouldn't do it this way because it's going to cost me twice as much later in tooling. Right.
Yep.
You know, and really we're thinking all the time about how can it be manufactured at the price point that's going to allow them to make the maximum amount of margins that they need, so that they can come back to us again and we can repeat it on another product.
Love that. Okay. Okay. I see we have a few live people out there. Thank you for the one like out there. It's awesome. If anybody has any questions for Rodrigo, we got him for another 15 minutes. I want you guys to bring those questions on. He's here to answer anything related to design, product design, manufacturing, it sounds like as well. Yeah. I put the title up there, top three tips. If you could just off the top of your head, I don't give you any warning.
Okay.
For someone getting into this for the first time, what should they be thinking about?
I mean, the first thing you want to do is you want to write the idea down. You want to sketch it out. You know, I typically, so number one, sketch it out and draw it out, right? To the best of your ability. You don't have to be a, you know, Da Vinci or anything, but you should be able to just rough it out, you know, a sketch so that everybody can understand, you know, so you can start understanding the product better, right?
Yep.
So
you don't need to build it necessarily. Just go get it on paper, pen and paper.
Get it on paper because it starts becoming more real as you first put it on paper. Or also, it's just, I had a podcast that I spoke with somebody the other day, today actually, and Cody, who's working on a product called the Ventorake, and he came up with this idea 21 years ago. And sometimes you don't have the means to do these things for a while, you know, and an idea is sitting there, and he went. And you know, every time he went to Home Depot, he kept being reminded of his idea. So, you know, eventually he did it, man. But it starts with drawing it out, writing it out, and that creates intent. And that creates, you know, energy being dedicated towards that idea. Now it's something that could be real, right? Now it's not just a thought anymore, you know? So that's the first thing. Write it down, sketch it out to the best of your ability. Number two, do a quick Google patent search. I usually like to recommend they do that just to get an idea. That being said, there's no way that an average person can do the same quality of patent search as a trained professional, right? But I do think it's important to at least have a general idea of what they can find, what they see on, you know, what your competition look like patent wise.
Love that.
And then the next thing is to, you know, you really want to have a, you want to work with somebody that has a plan for you. You know what I'm saying? Like there's people that'll just make you a prototype, but is that really what you want? Do you want to make a prototype or do you want to sell your product? Do you want to manufacture a product and then sell it? Right. It's two completely different things. A prototype, you know, can be used just to show how it looks, but a more refined prototype will show exactly how it's going to be manufactured and have the files, the 3D files to back that.
Got it. Love that. Right. So someone is kind of taking a longer term plan, you know, so you get all the way to market. And as you were kind of talking about with that first idea, right? Don't just go build it so you can hold on to it, build it and think about it so you can think about, you know, the cost, right? Well, how you're going to have to make it, what the tooling is like, all that.
Yeah. And then, I mean, I know it's not fun, but creating a business plan can be extremely, informative when you're putting any idea forward. And it does take time to try to understand how much each step will take and what it looks like. But that gives you the information to know how many you ultimately need to sell to make the money you're trying to make on the investment.
Love that. All right, Rego, you're going to help us critique. We're doing our bold bite segment and we're going to go to it now. I've picked this one out. This was a very simple idea. One of these things that's like, I'm sure people that are watching or have seen our stuff, they think, oh, I'm not really an inventor. I just have this idea, because it's just a very subtle improvement of an object that I think most of us have seen. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to switch over my mic. Okay, I got that set up. And let me know when I'm, if you can see my screen, Matt. Here we go. Present. There we go. Window. Okay. And Mark Cuban gets offended big time. You guys will love this. Get a kick out of it.
All right. Let's see. Good?
You guys got audio?
Yep.
Next into the tank is a modern version of a stale car accessory.
Hey, Sharks, I'm Trey Brown.
And I'm Don Brown.
We're two brothers from Los Angeles seeking a $200,000 investment for 5% of our company.
Imagine a peaceful day on the road, wind blowing, sun shining.
You're bumping your favorite track, cruising down the back streets, just catching a vibe.
But then that smell hits you.
A nearby landfill, spilled coffee, even forgotten French fries can turn your car from an oasis into a horrible, stinky nightmare.
For years, the problem of a stinky ride has been solved by a series of ugly and unstylish air fresheners.
So we created Ride Fresh, the world's flyest air freshener brand. I know you guys are probably wondering, why paper air fresheners? When you do a little sniffing around, you'll figure out that it's an untapped market.
At Ride Fresh, we offer a subscription-based car air freshener brand with unique scents and designs that'll be sure to blow you
and your customers'
minds.
We have amazing scents like wood grain. Wow.
Eucalyptus. I love this one, bro.
Nice. And even your favorite basketball teams. This one smells like winning.
Sorry, Mark.
The reality is that air fresheners have had no innovation in far too long.
And they smell whack. Hey, bro.
What's up?
I think I'm smelling the deal. With the help of the Sharks, we can make Ride Fresh explode! Sharks, in front of you, you'll find a series of our Ride Fresh scents. Please feel free to crack them open and enjoy.
Wow. After that, we can't even function.
Mark, are you okay? You're kind of still over there.
Ooh, you know what?
Dumbest
you
marketing know move ever. I'm out.
What?
Seriously. You got offended, man.
You got to read the room. Wrong move, wrong time. What are you upset about?
Yeah, why?
What do you think? One air freshener from the NBA is the team that beats us in the NBA Conference Finals. Got to know that could backfire.
You're a bigger man than that. Cut it out.
Yeah, I could be, but I'm not.
Wow.
But we have them in pairs. And that's $825 with shipping. And then the highest one is $10.99. Yeah. So 38 cents is our cost landed.
Out of the $540,000 you did last year, were you profitable?
Yes.
Yes. What did you make?
$40,000 in profit.
Wow.
$40,000?
Thank you. Wow. Thank you, guys. Smells.
How many did it sell?
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, of course.
Are there other ways that you can help us in terms of a strategic partnership in exchange for maybe 15% for the 200K?
I would have to say 15%, definitely not. I think this is going to be a lot of work to sell this. Thinking about
200K again. For 20?
What?
For 20%?
Contingent on those two big deals.
Contingent on those two deals.
You got it.
Okay.
All right, guys. What do you think? I want to go over to you, Matt. Talk trademarks, your perspective, quick. Let's go.
Yeah, I mean, funny enough, I've done some litigation against one of those air freshener companies that we saw.
To be mentioned.
No, not this particular one. But anyways, I would say interesting, but it's not. It's an air freshener. Right. I don't get what sets them apart from others besides the kind of bad name. So I guess I don't get it personally.
Okay. But why, I mean, just offhand, why, you know, fresh, are they going to be without the letter E?
I think that from a branding standpoint, I just think it's just, you know, you're basically saying fresh, but you're spelling it. People are going to be confused when they try to search for it. You're letting other people basically use the word fresh in that space when you could have it on lockdown if you had a more unique brand. I'm trying to get into their application. They had an application with USPTO since 2020. Might have actually been even before that. It might have been 2018, thinking about it. But essentially, they were not allowed to register the trademark. Okay. So, you know, we'll see if they ultimately get it. But at this point, it doesn't look like it.
Okay. They did. I mean, their major differentiator was kind of the way that they're selling through this subscription model. That was the only way they've gone to market. It was very interesting. But they were saying Uber drivers, you know, those that drive all the time, it's just easy for them to pop them in and out. And they have different interesting smells, but no distinctive characteristic. I was searching for something patentable, of course. From the design perspective, if they had it shaped in a very unique shape, okay, that's a potential for a design patent. But the things are square. If they had at the molecular level, okay, a truly unique smell, you could actually get a patent on this, on the actual substance, right? But those are usually kept as trade secret. Think about perfumes and colognes, okay? Those are super, you know, hard to, you can't actually reverse engineer many of those to find out what chemical or what fragrance is involved. So, Rodrigo, I wanted to get your opinion on something, you know, relatively simple, right? And trying to innovate and go to market with that.
So on this guy's product that we just looked at, man. I mean, I think it's, look, in terms of, okay, low cost to manufacture, right? So that's a positive.
I think it's at 31 cents, right? Would that be about where you'd put it?
I don't know. It depends on volumes. You know what I'm saying? It depends if you're buying 1,000 or if you're buying 100,000 pieces. But in terms of like getting to get to an actual sellable product, that a benefit of that is that there's some stamps and tooling that has to be made, but there's not so much. So that means that the money out of the investment actually goes more towards product and marketing. And honestly, the marketing is what makes this product. The subscription plan is a good idea, in my opinion. Right. I mean, you know, they're playing with, it's a licensing play, man. They're trying to get company team logos, but you have to have good connections to get those deals. And a lot of them cost money, right? You have to pay a fee to be able to use their brand on your product.
Yeah,
right. A lot of times they'll also take a percentage of anything that's sold or whatever. I'm not the too keen on that stuff, but.
Oh, and their margins were razor thin. I mean, you heard them. I mean, $500,000 sale, $40,000 profit. I mean, that's pretty thin. And so if someone, the licensing now gives me on top of that, they might be close to zero profitability.
I mean, was that year one? I don't know if that was year one or year two. I don't know where they're at in the
process. That was the most recent year, they were saying. Yeah, they sold 1.2 million over the past 3 years.
But 3 years.
Yeah, okay. I mean, the most recent year was just over $500,000. So,
I mean, who knows how much of that money is actually what they're paying themselves to run the business as well. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yep.
So, I mean, there's 50K, 100K each one of them right there. That's like half of that potentially, you know? Yep,
absolutely. All right, guys, we'll keep the questions coming. Yeah. We have 5 more minutes left. We have 3 preloaded questions. Matt, I want to make sure we get to these from our Avo askers. Sure. This one's out of Austin, Texas here. And it's like they're in the middle of filing on their own. No. Let's see if you can help them out. So it's a little bit long. I'll put it up on the screen so you can read it. So in the process of filing the paperwork for a trademark for their business, the questions regarding additional statement portion of the form. I'm pasting the information requested below. The additional statement section of the form is used to enter various legal or informational statements that might pertain to the mark. For example, a disclaimer. Anyway, what do you think about that? And maybe it's a really simple field that is normally filled out all the time. Does that ring a bell? What typically is a good idea to put there?
Yeah. So looking at the question, so it looks like they probably got an office action, which is an issue during the registration process at the USPTO. The examining attorney probably said, hey, this word is descriptive of the product or service for, you know, the application. We need you to disclaim it, right? And so you have to go back and you have to respond to that office action with a specific form at the USPTO. You get a variety of different options in terms of how you're going to respond to that office action. One of them is to pick, you know, change the additional statement, right? Or enter an additional statement, disclaimer, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Fill out the field, right? There's a whole section there for that. Very purpose, translations, pseudonyms, miscellaneous statements. It's all kind of in that form at the USPTO. And so you enter that, then submit it. But the important thing is that whenever you get an office action, assuming that the examining attorney has a valid argument and you're going to, you know, go along with the examiner, that you make sure that you answer or respond to that office action with everything they asked. So sometimes, you know, you'll get 2 or 3 different types of office actions, or, you know, 2 or 3 issues in an office action. You need to respond to all 3 or all 2 in the office action response.
Got it. And in terms of disclaiming, I know we've had to do that for our firm. We had, you know, bold IP, for example,
yep.
You know, property.
Yep.
The IP part is disclaimed, right? Because it just describes right. What it is. So that probably may have been, who knows?
Yeah, it's interesting, right? So like best practice when I was just beginning to be a trademark attorney was to never put a disclaimer in, right? So like bold IP, we would never put a disclaimer in for IP.
Just go.
Never know. Maybe you sneak it through, right? And all of a sudden you have these like incredible statutory rights that are challengeable, but you go for it, right? And then worst case scenario, you get an office action and you respond and, you know, examiner's amendment, or you go and respond and make the disclaimer. Nowadays, I'm much more inclined to put the disclaimer in there, especially if it's very obvious, because there's the possibility that when the examiner comes back and issues their office action, he or she is going to assess $100 fee.
Okay.
For that issue response.
Yeah.
Because the application wasn't filled out correctly the first time.
So you're asking for too much.
90% of the time, an examiner will never do that, but there are examiners who do it and it's annoying. And so a lot of times these days, I'll just go ahead and put the disclaimer in there.
Okay. Lime Design, is it kind of similar for Rodrigo? You know, by the way, are you registered, Rodrigo?
I have the word mark, not the icon.
Cool. Do you know if you got Lime and then had to disclaim Design? Were you able to get both words?
We've got Lime Design.
Hey, nice.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah, good. I like it.
Actually, can you grab it? It's on the wall.
I see it right up there. Oh, you got the trademark registration?
Yeah. No, not.
It's in yeah.
The one that says up next to the certificates. Yeah. It says Lime Design trademark. Sweet. Yeah.
Well, good for you.
And I actually want to do the logo mark, the icon, you know.
Yeah, with the light bulb up there and kind of the angle on the I&M. Oh, that's legit.
Yep. He's 100% correct. He's got principal registration, no disclaimer to the word design. It's good.
Awesome.
Because it's a composite trademark, and right, and so they look at both the words Lime and Design. If they're both descriptive, then the whole trademark is descriptive, because Lime has nothing to do with design. It's like Apple for computers.
Right.
There's a lot of registered Lime and Design as one composite trademark. Mm-hmm. If he had separated the two, Lime space Design, he'd have to disclaim the word Design.
There you go.
Okay.
Awesome.
Let's see.
So if I was going to go into a new, you know, design company and launch something that was like, you know, similar. I don't
know, lemon design?
Huh? You say lemon lime with me?
Lemon design.
Lemon design, yeah. Would that be too close?
Way too close.
Yeah, there you go.
In terms of my opinion, Rodrigo owns the citrus.
But who would want to do lime? Right? Or, all the fruits We're knocking at you. That's awesome, man. No, it's
if somebody wanted to make like kiwi design, or I mean, I think I've actually heard of that one before.
But like, let's go get them.
Yeah. I mean, for real, somebody comes up with lemon design, though, like you were saying. I mean, is that something that
lemon design is too close?
Boom.
What makes it too close, man? You know what I'm saying? It's a similar fruit. It's a different color.
Yeah, well, I mean
it's a color. Is lime a fruit?
Right. So it's a citrus. It's closely related to limes. Easily confusable with lemons. It sounds kind of similar. You know, it's. You know,
I like the mind of an attorney, man. It's really cool to see, you know, how to think like you guys are thinking, you know.
You bet. Yeah. I mean, what Matt always says, I mean, the trademark is when it comes down to it, that is the value of the company, right? That is what your customers know you as. That is what you've built up over all these years.
Yeah.
Means so much.
Right? When you go sell the company, right? In the end of the day, you get $1 million for your company and you have assets and liabilities and you take those out, you're left with the goodwill of the brand, right? So it's always someone's buying the business, and that's why customers come to you. Is because of the goodwill of the business, right? So that's the trademark. It's worth protecting, you know, for most clients.
All right, we gotta talk about getting this the other trademark then done, you know?
Let's do it.
And then after that, it's like there's like, I know there's something with like the registration and like,
yeah, you're coming up for renewal. You're coming up for renewal. So we could probably, you know, get that all done at the same time. So nice. October 16th, 2023, we gotta start thinking about filing renewal.
Sounds good.
Thank you for coming on. I appreciate you being on our show here. My fault again for not getting you on right away. I will have to have you back on in about a month or two. We'll get to some fun examples.
Let's do it, man. I'd love to, man. I love the way you guys do your shows, man. Really, there's a lot of – you make it fun, man. You know, like
– absolutely. Legal stuff doesn't have to be boring, you know. And so I love you jumping in on our Shark Tank Bold Bite as well. So Matt, thank you for making this a trademark focus today and keeping us in check, even our guests taking care of them on the trademarks side of things. So you guys have a good rest of your day and goodbye to everybody out there. We'll see you next week, 1:30 Pacific. Go big, go bold.